Carl here from Games, Brrraaains and Head-Banging Life, and ahead of their brand new album Curse of Autumn being released on March 5th, 2021, I had the pleasure of sitting down and chatting with Joseph of Witherfall. Joseph is the vocalist and keyboard player as well as one of the main songwriters. Curse of Autumn is Witherfall at their best. There's a strong argument here that this is the crowning glory of the band. And in this interview, we cover a lot of details surrounding it, stories about how it was made, the processes involved, even deep delving into the color red and the themes behind that, as well as a lot more. It is a very conversational style interview. So we hope you enjoy. Sit back and give it a listen. First things first, Joseph, cheers for joining me here. And I want to check up on you. How you been holding up the last 12 months of what is the COVID times? How you been holding up throughout it?
I'm a workaholic. So I'm here every morning after the gym in my office/studio, writing, recording, doing all this business admin for, you know, various parts of my business. So I've been doing okay. Yeah. You know, I don't go out party that much. I mean, it's enough when you're on tour, which, well, yeah, I mean, I guess I kind of miss that. So, other than being sick earlier on when this whole thing started, I've been doing pretty good.
Yeah. What about the band as a whole? Like, how much of a negative effect has it had on you guys as a unit? Like, has it separated you more?
No, I mean, Jake and I get together and write every chance we can. Yeah. Actually, I just came back from Florida. He's down there hiding out. He's going to need that vaccine.
Florida.
Yeah, it's really bad. It's really bad. I walked into a supplement shop, like a GNC, and the guy at the counter is not wearing a mask. Like, there's signs on some of the doors, like, no masks allowed.
Oh.
Like, crazy. Oh. Yeah, like, no masks allowed. Like, some of the restaurants out there, none of the staff wears masks, and they won't let you come in if you have one.
Wow.
So you wonder why the U.S. is having such a problem.
Yeah. I mean, here in England.
Anyway,
Yeah, here in England, we're not exactly flying by brilliantly either. I'm sure you've seen.
I wish I was in England. 500,000 dead people is kind of hard to beat.
Yeah, that's true. What about staying in a positive mindset then? What if anything has helped keep you kind of focused? Is it just working?
Yeah, it's the working, it's the writing. Witherfall and myself in particular have always used like negative things that are happening around me as sort of like a vehicle for writing. Making lemonade, I guess.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, that's all. I mean, that's what you're supposed to do. I mean, I think that's what defines an artist, really. I mean, there's like a serious artist and like there's like a pop culture artist, you know, where you're just kind of a vehicle for the party.
Right.
Okay, like Justin Bieber is not making any statements with his songs. He's not even writing them, but like it's just like they're like the DJ, you know.
Yeah,
like just there to facilitate young people having fun, which nothing wrong with that. There's always been that kind of music.
Yeah, and there always will be. That's what charts, that's what's gonna be in the popular places basically. But talking about Witherfall in general then, so obviously as a time of recording, we're just over a week away from the release of Curse of Autumn. Is the excitement still there for you? Or is it kind of desperation just to get it out now?
No, I want people to hear it. I mean, that's part of the fun is when you share it and you see like what, if people get it, you know, like that's the fun part.
Mm.
Is seeing like if people pick up the little things that are in there, the nuances, and, you know, like, you hope that some people listen to the whole thing from front to back and, like, really get what we're doing, you know. I mean, sure. I have no problem with the Spotify thing, but it does screw up some of the compositional aspects of what we're doing, because the whole thing is composed front to back. It's not just interspersed songs.
Yeah, of course. I mean, if you're trying to tell a story, not necessarily a concept album or anything like that, but if you're trying to tell a story across 10 or 11 tracks and you're just picking the singles out, mm-hmm. it's going to be lost, really, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, a lot of our concepts are pretty nebulous and like the same way that like you have a dream and there's a flow to it, but you know, your brain just grabs things and arranges them. You know, it's not like you're the person experiencing it is the central character. It's not like our concept records don't have like, you know, an elf that's walking through the woods that you're following around. Like, you listening are the central character, and we're taking you through the emotions that we felt, and kind of, it's almost like our concepts are like virtual reality glasses. So like whoever has them on is experiencing it.
Okay. And do you enjoy then that the people that do break it apart, so to speak, you touched upon listening and reading and hearing that people are deeper analyzing the music. That's something you enjoy then? Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, a lot of the stuff is personal too. So like, you wait for the people that this is about, like, to catch on and get it sometimes.
Oh, wow.
I mean, for better or worse.
What about if, say, specific song, specific event, and fans are taking their own ideas from it? Which do you prefer? Do you want them to get the message that you're trying to relay, or just enjoy it how they want to?
I mean, I don't think there would be a Judas Priest if fans weren't allowed to take the fucking songs their own way than the intended background. No, I mean, art, like I said, art is experienced. It's not like going to McDonald's and you order it and like they're like, here it is. Like, you know, art's like you build your own. So.
And what about the new?
I mean, there's no.
Sorry, go on.
Like a painter, the art galleries don't have like a button you push that tells you. Like, God, I hope they don't. In the future. Like that, it pushes it. It tells you exactly what this is about and what's going on. Like, I mean, I don't know. That we don't go into too much detail for that reason. I think it's better for the listener to imagine while they're listening.
Yeah, I'm sure you've had it in your music listening life where you've heard a song, thought of it in some way, and then eventually found out it actually means this and you've been completely wrong.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I'm a big Guns N' Roses fan, so you listen to like Use Your Illusions 2 and I don't even want to know what the hell's going on in Axl's mind and some of that stuff. I'm quite happy just listening to the pretty melodies.
No, that's cool. That's cool. So when it came to Curse of Autumn, was there a singular goal that you guys wanted to reach, or in regards to how you wanted it to sound, beyond obviously you wanted to keep it very Witherfall?
Yeah. We definitely knew this record needed to be, I don't want to say like drier, but it's a lot less ambient than Prelude. You know, a lot more hard hitting and like where you can really feel the transients. I mean, Prelude to Sorrow is like you're in a swamp. You know, the mix, the arrangements, the songs, like you were like trapped in there and you can't get out. This one really has some speed to it. you know, like it doesn't sit in one place. It's not as doomy. So we really wanted to match that with the production. Like you don't hear quite as many keyboards on it for that reason. This was more of a, like a high velocity record. And not just because some of the songs are faster, but we didn't want to like weigh it down with so much ambience in certain spots. I mean, it's, of course, we can go through like 12 different genres in one song.
Yeah.
So there's going to be, you know, there's going to be some of that like mud and gloom.
Well, of course, I mean, you obviously have some epics on it as well. And obviously it's very larger than life. You talk about dark melodies, you talk about a heavy metal headbanging side of it. That ballads that you've talked about, the different genres you've included and so on, how difficult is it for you as a unit to get that balance right though, where it is Witherfall, but it's also your progression?
Well, I mean, Jake and I are the songwriters and we don't really think about it, honestly. Like we do the old school thing where, you know, we have ideas that when we go to write, we just bring to each other and just listen, play. Like I'll play something on a piano or a guitar, or, you know, I'll hum it or I'll write it down, whatever. And then Jake has his ideas and then whatever clicks, we just start working on. It's very like Lennon McCartney, like in the room, let's get the like actual reaction and vibe and how it feels, you know, like performing it for each other. Even if it's just like really crappy humming or like, you know, a sloppy like guitar representation of a riff. And then we, you know, we get it down on paper or in Pro Tools, and we don't really have any intention while we're writing. We're just trying to write songs. And then once a few songs start to manifest, then it becomes really obvious like what the shape of the record's going to be. And at that point, we start contacting Christian Walling and saying, hey, like here's a couple of demos. Here's the mood of the record. And we're thinking this color scheme, you know, like, what do you think? And then he'll send us a sketch. And by the time we get the sketch, we have more of an idea of what the concept is. And then he goes in with the sketch and then does the color that he sees. Like, we knew this was going to be a red album.
Yeah.
But then in the middle, we had like the river and Tempest, which kind of brought in another hue. And that's how that burnt sienna color came in. So yeah, I mean, like we don't write as like a band. Like we don't do like the whole rehearsal room thing. Like everything is composed by Jake and I, and then those guys generally don't hear anything until we book the studio time, and we give them like 2 weeks like to listen and bring their ideas. But I mean, we pretty much know what we want, especially like I'm really involved in like where the feel is on the drums. I mean, I never go in and just tell anyone what to play, but I know where I want the snare drum, like whether it's on the backbeat or like if a kick drum is going to push on a certain thing, like it's written into the composition. You know, like I play percussion on some of it, but you know, when we work with a percussionist, like I'm there directing it the whole way. Like everything is really orchestrated. We know what we want.
Yeah, reading, you do some general reading about you, and the word fluid, you've talked about fluid in interviews in the past and stuff like that in regards to your writing style, and I think that's fascinating. You basically never really stop, right?
No, we don't stop at all. It's weird too, because we had the song The Other Side of Fear, at least the beginnings of it, like we had the chorus and the main riff that happens after the chorus and kind of the verse basically ready to go, like in the stages where we knew what the song was going to do, but we just never finished it. Like we wrote it right after Nocturnes, and we were thinking it was going to be on Prelude to Sorrow, but then the album ended up being about Adam, and we're like, this isn't about Adam. So we never even worked on it after that. We just kind of like left it as a file on the thing, and we never finished it. And then when the angry Levian type theme started to happen with this record, we're like, "Other Side of Fear, definitely we'll finish it, and it'll be on this record." But yeah, we don't stop. Even when we think we're done with a record, the river was very late in the game on this. It just happened. Like, Jake sent me like a little phone recording of an acoustic guitar after his tour with Demons and Wizards. I heard the melody immediately. I took it into Pro Tools and I edited it so it fit the melody I heard in my head. And then, you know, we went from there. Same thing with the song from Nocturnes, The Great Awakening, wasn't going to be on that record, but like a week before we went into the studio, Jake showed up at my house like after a show I was playing with another band at like 2 a.m. and he showed me the idea, and I like wrote the melody on the spot, and so that we ended up recording that song the next week in the studio.
Incredible.
We don't start. We just wrote La. I just, like I said, I got back from Florida and I have 11 new caterpillars sitting in the theater. I mean, we work fast.
So you obviously, you know, the pair of you are encouraging each other clearly to keep, but who's there to tell you to stop, so to speak, and maybe that song's done or maybe that's in place? Are you both doing that as well?
Yeah, I mean, the song is done when it's perfect, or at least the arrangement's perfect. You never know what's going to happen when you go to perform it, you know, like that can't be controlled. But it tells you, I think, right? I mean, like speaking of Christian Wallin, he can take a month to do one of his oil paintings, or like it could be 3-4 months. Like for this record, like he sent us a cell phone capture of it, and I thought it was done. I was like, this thing's done, that looks great.
Yeah,
and he's like, no. And then he took like 2 more months. and when I looked at the little screen grab and then the final thing, and I noticed all the little things that he had put in there at the last minute that like really made it like more moody. And so he knew it wasn't done. And, you know, we kind of work the same way. Like when it's done, it's done. You know, you'll just know. Like the river looks like it's really simple, but I mean, in that acoustic guitar part, there are meter changes every couple of bars. Like it's just not sitting in 4/4. You know, like in the chorus vocal melody is like a 3/4 pattern. It makes no sense when you think about it, like when you look at it on paper, but then you hear it and you're like, oh, like even in the studio when Marco was doing the drums, he kept playing on the heavy part. He kept playing to Jake's guitar without really thinking, like, you know, like I don't think we even had in his headphones the vocal. So I had to go in the control room and there's a piano and I'm like, no, listen to the melody, like here, stick that right and then play the melody. And he, you know, I mean, he's a fucking great musician, he knew immediately what was going on. And then I leave the live room and he does it in the next take or two. You know, it's very complex, even though it sounds like, you know, like if you're like a beginning guitar player, you're like, I can play this is easy, like, but to write it, it just, you know, it makes no sense at all on paper. Like absolutely no sense.
Is that the I don't want to say proudest, because all your proudest moments, but that particular track, The River, considering its incredibly personal nature of that track, is that the one perhaps you're most I don't know, nervous about fan reaction wise or excited?
I'm excited. It seems to be getting a pretty good reaction.
Yeah.
It was actually nerve-wracking going into the production with John, because he didn't like the verse melody, the clean part.
All right.
He thought it could be developed more, and I, you know, I had to like fight. You know, like, and it's John Schaefer, you know, who's definitely has he has work to back him up, like his opinion. And but I knew, like, no, it has to be like this. This conveys the mood of it exactly how I want it. And, but the nerve-wracking part is, am I gonna do it like justice? Is it gonna come across, you know, the weight? Is it gonna have the weight that I'm intending on it? You know, and I mean, that honestly, that's where John really shined was. Yeah, once he knew that I wasn't gonna like change it, then he was just like, I think Jake said in an earlier interview that we hired John to be like the drill sergeant that won't let you, like, you know, get a pass. Like, no, it's not there. No, you know, and he's the way we recorded, we were all four of us, Jim, John, Jake, and I in the room, like whether it was guitars or vocals. So I'm like there and John's like staring at me in the face as I'm singing. Like, and, you know, you're watching, like, whether you're getting the emotional response you want, you're getting direct feedback. I think it's a really good way to work.
If it works for you, then brilliant.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know, maybe some guys like need to not have outside stimuli, but I actually like recording with an audience there, you know.
The end, continuing to talk about specific tracks, the end part of the album, I feel is going to cause a little bit of chaos amongst fans. Because first we've got the 15 plus minute epic, that is They All Blew Away. And then you follow that up with an acoustic version of Boston's Long Time. Now let's talk about the former first. Would you describe that as your most elaborate and lavish effort? Because goodness me, when you talked about stuffing a track full of things, this certainly might be the one, right?
Yeah, I mean, if we had to score that out, it would look the most scribbly for sure. You know, I mean, there's just meter changes and tempo changes like left and right. It's pretty crazy. I mean, a lot of that stuff you hear like is like me and Jake like at 4 a.m. and he's like playing something and I'm like, what is that? And I'm tapping on it. I'm like, oh no, you okay? It's 9/8. Like there's an extra eighth note, and then programming in like the click track just so we can get it down, make sure it actually is in 9/8, and then like moving on like that. And I mean, it's a lot of work to make it right, but. We don't, yeah, I mean, I don't think it would be possible, like, the way, like, modern metal is written, like, it's all, they go in and print the grid, or maybe, like, have, like, the fake drums on there, and then play the riff to that, like, we can never do that, like, because things like All Blew Away would never happen, like, you can never pre-plan in the writing, like, okay, like, we're going to drop the tempo 23 BPM, and now we're going to have a 7/8 section, like here, but for one measure, and then bring the tempo back up. Like you couldn't do that, and you couldn't play to it either. Like you have to like just go from your brain to like some way of transcribing it, and then keep working. But yeah, that took quite a while as far as doing that type of work. Like the conceptually, that's quick, that's flowing, and just like, oh yeah, okay. Like here's that Rob Zombie type feel with the drums on the ands, like, you know, like falsetto ooze over it. That stuff's easy because we're just like kind of like free flow, like, you know, what do you call that, when you have like a, I forgot, they used to talk about in school, I don't remember, but it's like where you just think words and you write them down. It's like, I forgot what that's called.
Yeah, it could ring a bell to me.
But yeah, the weird thing about that is, like, we actually wrote the version of Long Time on a break from writing the second half of All Blew Away.
Yeah.
So like, All Blew Away was probably written like over the course of 4 to 6 days. Like we start writing around 5 p.m., take a break around 9 or 10 for dinner, and then continue to like 6 a.m. And so like when you're working on something that is that long, and you kind of, if you keep going, you'll lose, you know, like emotionally where it's supposed to be, because yeah. it's such a like, I mean, it spans like 4 songs, like worth of time. So like you take a lot of breaks. We ended up like sitting in the living room away from the studio. And we do this all the time. So like our breaks actually include other instruments, just fucking sitting there drinking wine and, you know, playing a guitar. And I have like a little piano on my phone that I'll just pull out just, you know, when there's nothing else. And I was like singing this melody. And we thought we were going to do the full version of the song, like metal, kind of like, who did that version of Holy Diver?
Oh, Kill Switch Engage.
But they did it in like, yeah. So they did it in like a heavier way.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, we kind of were going that direction with it. And then we were like, it's too happy. It's too bouncy. You know, doom, doom, doom. Like, no. So we scrapped it, and we were working on this Springsteen song. We were working on a Queen song. And then we're like, let's go. I started humming this melody, you know, and then it's really sad. Like if you just listen to the melody and the lyrics especially, like, wow, what if we changed? What if we like went to the enharmonic minor chord? So instead of that major chord that sits there statically over the melody, what if we created a chord progression like the minor chord for that key and started singing the melody, and it got really deep. Mm-hmm. And I actually grew up in upstate New York, and I knew Tom Schultz. He used to come to my grandfather's lawnmower shop. And when I finally was getting into music and getting guitars and stuff, he had his own guitar shop with Joe Bonamassa's dad, like right around the corner from our house. And he used to sell me like really cheap, like good deals on, you know, not like really expensive guitars. I didn't have that much money, but stuff that he played, like some old Epiphone acoustics and things like that. Yeah. Well, I had run into him, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago or so. I saw him. I was back in my hometown. I'm like, what's going on with the band? And I hadn't heard that Brad Delp had killed himself. I didn't know. So it got kind of really weird and quiet. And, you know, he's like, oh, you didn't hear? And I'm like, what, hear what? You know, so it kind of took on a new meaning, that song, when we started working on it. I'm like, this song, if you look at it from, like, you know, Brad Delp's point of view, like, as he's like putting the fucking hose on his tailpipe in his garage, writing a note to his, you know, his ex-wife or whatever. Like, this is a really sad, depressing, like suicide note. That's what this song really is. Like, and then we took it from there. There's a full version of it too. We did the actual full version, but it dips down into that acoustic,
yeah,
and then comes back up with a big like rock outro type thing. That's like a bonus track that'll come out after the record's out, but for the record, it didn't fit our record. Like, it fits our record as like the quiet after the storm, you know, like here's like the breeze after everything's over with that will lead you into the next record. But we did actually record the entire
okay
and arrange it. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, kind of.
We knew it went.
Yeah, well, in a written review that comes out in a few days, for me it was like the rub down after a workout, you know, you got a 15 plus minute workout that's really beforehand and then you just needed that calming, let your muscles relax, yeah, finale.
Yeah, I mean, we do that a lot, like with Epilogue on the last record. It's like, because we carry these themes, you know, throughout our discography, and it just needs, it can't end there. There's no way it could end the way All Blew Away ended. It needed a prolonged breath.
Absolutely. So, you know, you guys obviously really enjoy what you're doing there, but there's an aspect of being in any band these days that seems to cause a bit of dispute between what you enjoy and what you don't. And I want to see from your perspective, social media, the demand from a fan base and everyone for you guys to always be online. How do you handle that?
Do
you enjoy it?
I handle it well. I do a lot of work on social media. Jake hates it. Absolutely.
Yeah.
you know, the other members have their own projects, so a lot of their social media is focused on that, unless there's like a specific thing going on. You know, the problem with social media is that the standard practices, the best practices, aren't really conducive to like art or mystique or the things I enjoy about a band. Like if you look at, like, before social media, like Slash is like one of the coolest human beings ever. Like, because you only see Slash or like someone like a Jimmy Page or Brian May in their element. Like they are gods. Like, and you associate them with the message and the vibe of their music, and that's it, right? Now you go to Brian May's Instagram and you see him in his fucking pajamas and he's being all dorky, and you know, he's, you know what I mean? Like, or like Slash is like eating a burrito in fucking Paso Robles. Like, and I get it, like, because it's that constant like hit, like, for social media, and you know, that's what drives like the streaming paradigm, is that you have to keep reminding people that you exist.
Yeah.
Whereas before you just sell a $10 CD or even like a dollar download. Now to make up that economic, you know, shift, you have to keep pushing the button so that people keep seeing, you know, like, oh, I want to listen to Queen now. Like, I just saw Brian May post something. It's hard because we, you know, you never see us do like a live stream of us like singing, or we won't do it. Like, it degrades the art. Like, we will not do it. We try to split the difference sometimes, where we try to make our stuff like either really vague or really interesting. But it's very difficult to be an artist and not like a product. I think the pop world, with all the money, and I pop doesn't mean like pop music, it just means what's selling right now. You know, like pop was Led Zeppelin, let's just be honest. Has nothing to do with the genre of music. But the artists with big machines behind them, I mean, they're doing better than metal in the art department as well, because everything they post is art. Every time Miley Cyrus does a live stream, I mean, they have professional hair and makeup, photography, like, it's all, you know, great sound. And then you see like Dave Ellefson, and he's like got his cell phone and, you know, his hair is all jacked up, and I love Dave Ellefson, but I think that they're really making a mistake. And that's why like metal has really taken a turn for the worse in the eyes of the general music listening public, especially the youth. Like, there's no swagger or finesse or coolness at all right now, because no one wants to spend any money, and everyone, like, it's almost like it's become like punk rock, you know?
Yeah.
Like, the metal guys were the ones with the money and the nice clothes and the, you know, the photographers following them around, and the punk rock guys were like, you know, I'm not going to brush my hair or my teeth, or, you know, I'm not going to tune my guitar. And now it's like, it's totally shifted. Like, I don't know. I think that's a big problem. I think that you're not going to see it. Like a revival of the heyday of heavy music until the majority of the bands out there are more cognizant of what's going on. I mean, you got certain bands like Perfect Circle. They have a great like production aesthetic. They know how to still look cool. Avenged Sevenfold has their whole marketing thing down, like their image. Opeth still looks cool. But I mean, you can just scroll through the metal section of YouTube and it's just like, are we all garage bands now? Like,
yeah. And you're almost unfairly judged if you're not that, like, why aren't you more active on social media, guys? You don't care about your fans, and it's unfair, really.
Yeah. I mean, like, I know Jake, what he would say is he would rather spend more time writing music, or, you know,
of course.
It used to be about your contacts and your record sales, but now, like, they look at your YouTube views or
your likes,
you know, all these other men. Yeah, and it's like, well, if we sell 10,000 records plus another 1,000 vinyl, that certainly makes up for the fact that the streaming numbers aren't that good, but that's just not what people are looking at nowadays.
It will help. It will help when you're able to get back out live, I think.
Definitely. Because you get that, you know, multiple exposures from different outlets. So like when you go through a town, you know, multiple places are talking about it every day. You get different sources. So you do get like a huge increase in activity, especially like in any of the localities that you're at. But it's hard to see. It's hard to quantify. And it's not like, you know, being on the radio and you know you're on the radio and you know your record's going to do well. Like, you don't see all this stuff in the algorithms going on that, you know, it's going to help you. You just don't see it. You just kind of have to trust the algorithm God.
I hate that word algorithm. It's the bane of modern existence.
I know, right? It's dirty. It's manipulated.
Mm-hmm. And changed every couple of months. The goalposts constantly move. So exactly. Last but not least.
I know a guy on a pretty...
Sorry, go on.
I was going to say, I know a guy that runs a pretty big heavy metal gear channel.
Oh.
He's a good friend of mine. And like every time the YouTube algorithm changes, like he sees his like view count go down for no reason, until he figures out how to hack that one, you know.
I don't envy anyone like that has to constantly work around it, you know, be it their income or a part of their income.
Right. Yeah. It's crazy. And you gotta know that, like, whoever the parent company, which is, I think, Google, right?
Yeah.
Like YouTube, they gotta have some. It's gotta be some insider information going to the bigger companies, record companies, or entertainment companies. Yeah, I mean, like the Universal movie studios, when they put out a trailer, they're gonna know what that algorithm's doing, and getting insider information. You know, like that, say like a mid-level metal band, like Amon Amarth is not getting.
I know exactly what you mean.
But it's probably going to get taken down if this ever goes up on YouTube. It'll just be like a big...
It's okay. As long as we don't play any music, we're sorted. No DMCA that way.
Yeah.
Last but not least, then, talking about live, you've got a big tour in the works. At the end of the year, you're in the UK, you're in Ireland, you're over Europe with Evergrey and Dust in Mind. Something that, at least for us in the UK, is looking a bit more realistic now. Now, we're super stoked because you're going to be playing London, the 229, which is like one of my favorite venues. We're in London. How are you guys feeling about it? And I presume it's just a matter of fingers crossed.
Yeah, I mean, I've never been to that venue, but if you're telling me it's great, then I'm looking forward to it. Being out on the road and hearing the like feedback like directly in your face from people is really rewarding. And you know, like you said, there's no real way to grow, you know, in this business without going out and touring. I mean, the whole thing like the way Pantera made it, like it's still there. Like people like to think it's all about, you know, catching a viral moment on social media. That's fleeting. If you're not out in front of people, it's not going to happen. As far as whether the tour is going to happen or not, I mean, I think we touched on this earlier. Like the United States has a massive problem with conspiracy theories and, you know, the anti-vaxxer movement and, you know, all this stuff. And I'm worried about, like, are we going to be on like a banned list? You know, like the rest of the world, like goes, okay, like intercontinental travel in Europe is fine, like except for like this country or that country that has some sort of issue like we do. Like, are we even gonna be able to get our work visas to go over there? Like, especially the UK, I don't think it's a problem going to like Germany or whatever, but you know, you need the government's approval to go and play a show in the United Kingdom. Plus a few hundred pounds.
There is that.
But I think it's going to be fine.
Yeah.
I think the only requirement may be that you have to have vaccination. And I'm certainly not an anti-vaxxer. And I certainly will get the damn vaccine as soon as my card comes up.
Yeah.
I mean, I get it. Like, everyone's like, oh, it was developed so quickly. I'm like, yeah, because they got to bypass all the time it takes to fund.
Yeah.
Like, that. It's not just the research part and the tests. It's the funding can take years on something that scale. And the government, you know, and not just the government, but some companies that are demonized right now, you know, funded this. I mean, that's my only concern is that we do such a piss poor job here that, I think this is lost too. I don't know if I'm rambling, but people don't understand virology, that if you let something get out of control, like that's when you invite all these mutations, because it's the number of replication will dictate how many mutations.
Yeah.
So, here in the US, it's just, they're like, oh, let everybody get it. Yeah, but now you've like opened the door for all these mutations. Like, if you just kept it at a small percentage of the population getting it, you know, there's not that much room for variation. It's not going to happen. I mean, there's an evolutionary process going on here that I don't think is really understood or talked about in the media. Like, it's not just about like, well, it only kills old people, and like if we just let everybody get it, we'll all be immune. It's like, no, well, the fucking thing will change faster. So that's more to your point. Yeah, I mean, it just all depends on how I don't know, man. It doesn't look as bleak as it used to, but yeah, we'll see if any of these variations cause people that get the vaccine to get sick. I think that's really the wild card.
It does still feel like we are in that position of let's wait and see. Your tour is the end of the year. There's plenty of time. We're only in February, so there's still plenty of time just to chill, relax, and potentially look forward to it. Correct me if I'm wrong. Your last time you were in the UK was your acoustic tour, right?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Of course.
Yeah, that was in London. It was just one show.
Yeah, that was great. I was there.
Oh, were you?
Yeah.
Jake was absolutely hungover.
No way.
Yeah, like I think there was like a, it was like a, like a little breakfast shop across the street, and he never gets up and has breakfast, but that day he sure did. You know, on the ferry they have like alcohol, so when we were coming over, him and a couple of the guys and the guys from Sonata were just on the boat the entire night, like drinking. Like I was you're not supposed to stay in the bus, but as a singer, I'm like, no, I will not get the sleep I need if I have to get off this thing. So I broke the rules. I slept on the bus. If it sank, I would have died. This is the price I pay for my art.
Yeah, no, fair. All right, Joseph, that's all I have for you. Thank you very much for your time. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for watching. You can check us out on gbhbl.com as well as on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter and Tumblr. Go to Patreon to help us out over there. That's patreon.com/gbhbl, as well as Big Cartel, where you can find some of our merchandise. We have a podcast running on SoundCloud and Apple Podcasts. And of course, if you like this video, do us a favour, hit the subscribe button and help the channel grow. Games, horror and heavy metal. What else is life for?